So, hello, dear participants of the Next Generation Police Project, and welcome to the first workshop that we organized for you. My name is Ekaterina, and I work at Buzar, and I'm a coordinator of the project Next Generation Police. So now, okay, let me introduce Frank, our first speaker, Frank Kras, a climatologist who is actually also Belgian, but he lives and works for many years in Italy, where he also teaching at the universities. He was previously working at the European Commission, where he was leading a climate change and air pollution research. He's also a founder of the Museum of Anthropocene Technology. This museum brings together artists and scientists to reflect on our global collective problems in general and climate change in particular. So please, Frank, I give you the word and enjoy the lecture.
Okay, thank you very much, Ekaterina. Well, good morning, everybody, wherever you are. Yeah, it's again a virtual meeting, but at least we can see each other without a mask. That's the positive thing. And we can join from wherever you are. No, that's also fantastic of these technologies. So this will be a presentation about climate change presentations. I hope that through this presentation, you will learn something about the climate change problem, of course. But I also wanted to show how the discourse about climate change has changed over the past 20 years. It's indeed about 20 years, exactly 20 years, in fact, that I talk about climate change to a large public, to students, to the general public. And I want to show how these presentations have been changing. They have been changing because in these 20 years, climate has been changing dramatically. In 20 years, I will show that. But also the politics of climate change, the action about climate change has been changing, and therefore also our presentations has been changing. So I'll do that, and also with the hope that maybe somebody of you listening to all these presentations or type of presentations will maybe stand up and also go out and talk about climate change or other collective issues we have nowadays. So as Ekaterina said, I wanted to do a live lecture performance at the studio of Beaux-Arts. We cannot do that. So we will start with a piece of a TED talk I gave 3 years ago already. And that's more or less what I wanted to do in the studio of Beaux-Arts. So Luna, if you can switch on the little video. Sound.
Utile vedere i cambiamenti climatici di oggi nel contesto dei cambiamenti avvenuti in tutta la storia della Terra, una storia lunga 4,5 miliardi di anni. Ma guardiamo solo gli ultimi 600 milioni di anni, da quando la vita è migrata dall'oceano alla terraferma. Dai reperti fossili sappiamo che ci sono state queste grandi estinzioni di massa causate da cataclismi naturali, no? Impatti meteoritici, attività vulcanica e poi i cambiamenti climatici che ne erano la conseguenza. Queste estinzioni di massa, questi strati di fossili, poi dividono la preistoria in ere geologiche. Il Giurassico, no? Ricordate il Giurassico, andava da 200 a 150 milioni di anni fa. I primi ominidi sono entrati in scena solo 7 milioni di anni fa e l'Homo sapiens è a malapena visibile su questo quadrante. Quindi faccio un reset dell'orologio e riparto 200.000 anni fa quando sapiens entra in scena. Ci sono poi le diverse rivoluzioni umane, quella cognitiva, poi quella agricola e quella industriale. Ed eccoci subito arrivati agli ultimi 200 anni, quelli moderni, quelli cosiddetto illuminati, dove troviamo musica, Haydn e una tale quantità di altre cose che devo leggervelo. Siamo 1 miliardo, tanto per cominciare, c'è il rumore delle macchine a vapore, macchine che consentono di fare macchine ancora più grandi. Il colonialismo, l'abbruttamento dell'uomo e i primi saccheggi del pianeta, ci sono le rivolte sociali, bombe e fertilizzanti, la grande guerra e l'esplosione demografica a livello mondiale. Siamo 2 miliardi, arrivano gli anni 30 con New York, che compete con Londra e Berlino. Il primo dispiegamento di armi di distruzione di massa, seguito dalla Dichiarazione Universale dei Diritti dell'Uomo, il petrolio, cioè materiale per la plastica, carburante per le automobili, città tentacolari. Siamo 3 miliardi, c'è domanda e offerta, produzione e consumo di massa, il glorioso anni 60, un'esplosione di creatività, la società dell'uso e getta, il primo trapianto di cuore, plastica ancora, plastica dappertutto, pesticidi, organismi geneticamente modificati, il freon e il buco dell'ozono, i viaggi nello spazio, il personal computer, Pac-Man, il Super Mario, CNN, MTV, Chernobyl, est e ovest, nord e sud, la Cina in mezzo, l'Africa dimenticata, internet, i mercati finanziari, la ricerca della sostenibilità, miniere aperto, la biodiversità, foreste bruciate, reti globali, il riscaldamento globale, il terrorismo globale, 20 miliardi di polli, automatici, trapianti di testa, la vita virtuale, siamo più di 7 miliardi e della disuguaglianza tra questa donna e questa qua che scatena conflitto dopo conflitto, emergenza dopo emergenza, disastro dopo disastro, guerra dopo... No, scusate.
So that's the first and the two pieces of lectures together, and I want to comment a little bit on that sort of approach. Of course, if you come to listen to a climate change presentation, you don't expect that sort of presentation, I think. And it happened indeed that after the presentation like this one, people came to me and say, but why do you show all these things? Why should I learn about dinosaurs and Mars extinctions and the origin of Homo sapiens? I mean, I come here to listen about climate change and about the solutions. I don't care about all these things. And then my answer is, well, I personally think that it is a fascinating story. I mean, the history of Earth and the history of man. And what is most fascinating about it is that we did not invent it, no? We know this story, this history of the Earth and mankind through scientific research, no? Through geology, through genetics, through all kinds of scientific disciplines. And so the message I wanted to show actually is that if we are able to put together in a coherent way the history of 4.5 billion years of Earth based on science, we will also be able to say something about the next 100 years, right? Based on the same science. So we will be able to say something of climate change of the next 100 years and what it means to humanity. So that's the first message, the strength and the role of science in all this. The second comment I want to make is that when I give that presentation to a public of let's say older people, my generation, the reaction is sometimes very strange. You know, sometimes there's a complete silence after the big explosion that you didn't hear now, but it's a big explosion, nuclear explosion at the end, and people are completely silent. And maybe I have scared them, maybe, or maybe I have hurted their political beliefs, because it also becomes a little bit political. And so there's that reaction by the older generation. The young generation, like you and schoolboys, well, after this explosion, there is a second explosion of applause and joy and excitement. And that tells me that your generation is seeing these problems, climate change and biodiversity loss and all these other big problems. You see it in a very different way. And that's actually, for me, a sign of, well, a reason for optimism, and I come back to that later. Anyway, the reason I show this movie, it's a way to show that indeed, seen on a geological time scale, we really find ourselves in an explosion. Things go faster and faster, very much like in an explosion. And that's an objective reason for concern, because nobody knows whether we have this explosion under control, right? So another way to show this explosion in a more sober way is to show a scientific graph. So we go now in a more scientific presentation. And what I show here is the average temperature of the Earth, the global average temperature, over the past 2,000 years, from time zero to 2000. Now, but you see that for a long time, the temperature has been slowly changing. Here, all of a sudden, it goes like this. So we really witness something which is explosive. That's the only term we can use. And these are measurements. This is the temperature of the Earth that by now in 2016 and also 2020, we are about 1.2 degrees hotter than we were at the end of the previous century. And if we compare that with another set of data, this is the CO2 concentration in the atmosphere that scientists are able to take from various proxy measures, tree rings and things like that. You see the same behavior. So it's rather constant over the past, well, actually over the past 10,000 years. And then since 200 years, we see this basic explosive growth of CO2 in the concentration of CO2. And now we know, science has discovered that CO2 is a greenhouse gas. So if you put more CO2 in the atmosphere, it will trap the heat in the atmosphere and it will lead to warming. So these two explosions in the CO2 concentration and in the global temperature are very much related, and we know why they are related. We also know that this explosive growth in CO2 in the atmosphere is due to the burning of fossil fuels, the burning of coal and gas and oil, which leads to CO2 and that we are pumping into the atmosphere. So the reason, the cause of these explosions is in fact humanity and human activities. So we have an increase in global mean temperature already, 1.26 it was in 2016. It was 1.24 in 2020, and that's compared to the beginning of the previous century. That's the global mean temperature. Now let's see what that means more locally. I show a map of the globe here. And again, I show the increase in temperature compared to the beginning of last century. So globally, the increase, this is 2000, I hope you can see that, this is 1980, it's 40 years ago. And the global mean temperature was an increase of 0.4. You can see that here in the right. I cannot see it because it's hidden by my picture. But you see that it's a global increase, but locally it can be very different. So that's 1980. That's 2000, 20 years later, and that's 2020. You see how even in 20 years, the temperature on Earth and locally has been changing quite a bit. So again, globally, it's 1.2 degrees increase. Locally, like over Europe, Western Europe, it's more than 2 degrees. And in the Arctic, it is even more than 4 degrees. So you see, you have a global value, but if you look more locally, the increase can even be larger, especially over the continents and especially in the north. So we have an increase of global temperature, but that is very different over continents, and that leads to the melting of glaciers. And it also leads to the melting of the Arctic ice pack, the ice over the North Pole. And that's rather important. And that's why I show it to you again. So again, we go to 1980. And we see the ice pack over the Arctic. That's the North Pole here. At the end of the summer, in September. So that's the minimum extent of the ice pack after summer. And that's in 1980. So that's in 2000. And that's in 2020. So the ice pack is indeed shrinking very fast. And by now it's possible to go from the North Atlantic by ship via the Northeast Passage to the Pacific. And or at times, like last year, 2 years ago, it was even possible to go through the Northwest Passage and go to. And this is being looked at by shipping companies, of course, because going from London to Japan, to Yokohama, for instance, is much shorter going this way than going through the Panama Canal and this way. And so this irony of things, climate change helps also these shipping companies, and they are watching that also very carefully. Okay, that leads to a positive feedback, because the less ice you have, the less light is reflected back to space, and the more light is being absorbed by the ocean, and that leads to more warming. So you start with warming and you end up with even more warming. So that's this arrow here. You melt the Arctic through global warming, you melt the Arctic, and that leads to extra warming. Now, melting glaciers and increase of global mean temperature and increase of the temperature of the ocean, that leads to sea level rise, plus 20 centimeters compared to the beginning of the previous century. And all these things together at the end, through a sequence, through a cascade of processes, they lead to the increase of extreme weather events everywhere on Earth, with loss of life, human life and non-human life, and economic damages. So that's important to realize. You start with the global effect, and through a cascade of processes, you increase extreme weather, which we witness now. And I show you a number of pictures that I took from newspapers in 2019. In 2020, newspapers were reporting on other things, but this is everything I got, or some things I got in 2019. That's the Arctic. That's not a picture you would expect of the Arctic. That's Siberia, above the Arctic line. Bologna, heat wave, drought in India, drought in California with forest fires, cold spells. That's important to realize. Climate change is not just global warming and warming. You have also cold spells, which we can explain. Nowadays, as we speak in Texas, it's very cold, it's snowing. And if you read the newspapers, you will see the explanation why that is. And it has to do with the melting of the Arctic, which makes it possible that cold air from the Arctic more easily gets to the south and gets all the way to Texas, as it happened now. So climate change is not just global warming, it's extreme weather events and other things. Cold spells, heat waves, floods and droughts. This is Venice, a big storm in Venice. This was during the Biennale. When I first saw this picture, I thought it was an artwork, to talk about climate change. But no, it was a real thing that happened, the storm that put the boats over the bridges. Indonesia and Australia, that you will remember, the forest fires during summer in Australia. Okay, these are pictures. This is a qualitative way of looking at climate change. You can say, well, these things have always happened. But this is the quantitative picture. No, there are people in the insurance world that very carefully look at these events. And this is numbers from Munich Re. That's an insurance company that insures insurance companies. So, also insurance companies are insured. They look very carefully at these catastrophic, natural catastrophes, they say, because they are afraid that they will have to pay for the ensured losses and that they will no longer be able to pay for that. So these are quantitative data of the last 40 years, and you see how they basically, the number of natural loss events have been nearly quadrupled. In 2020, there are about 1,000, and we start with 200 40 years ago. So this is really showing that something is happening, and which is also of concern for, well, for human loss, but also for economic loss and so on. Now, the thing is that all this, well, most of this has been predicted by climatologists 40 years ago. This is a paper from in Science, it's one of the major, together with Nature, the major scientific journals, in 1981, where Jim Hansen and his group already, first he showed the linkage, he proved that there is a linkage between carbon dioxide, CO2 in the atmosphere, and the increase in temperature and the impacts of climate. So the title is Climate Impacts of Increasing Atmospheric Carbon Dioxide. So he proved these linkages, and he already in the summary of the paper talks about potential effects in the 21st century, droughts in North America and Central Asia as part of shifting climate zones, erosion of the West Antarctic ice sheet, with consequent worldwide rise in sea level rise, and opening of the fabled Northwest Passage. So that's the passage from the North Atlantic to the Pacific via the North Pole. So due to the shrinking of the ice pack over the North Pole. So he talked about the 21st century. Well, already in the beginning of the 21st century, we see most of these all of these effects happening. And that's important. If science can predict something and then observations show that these predictions are true, that means that you really can believe in the science. And I can tell you the model, the climate model that Jim Hansen used for doing this paper is very much simpler than the models we are using now to predict the future. The models we use now are much more sophisticated, much more precise and detailed. And we can indeed say something sensible about the next 100 years. Okay, I have to make a comment here. This is a logical story, right? We have a climate system, we have humans that disturb the climate system, that leads to problems and damages and losses. And so it's only clear that we have to do something about it. And we also know how to do something about it. And so for a scientist, for a long time, we felt very frustrated that people did not get it, that people did not connect the dots. But then I realized, and many of us realized, scientists, that actually this logical story is only logical if you have a scientific training, of course, right? If you don't have a scientific training, or you had a training many, many years ago, a lot of the graphs we show don't say a thing, right? I gave a presentation some years ago for a group of professors in law, no, in rechten, le droit, professors in law from various universities in Europe. And I showed a graph like that, so the typical XY plot. Now, on the x-axis, you have the time going from 1900 to present, and on the y-axis, you have the temperature, and then you have a curve here which goes up. Well, for a scientist, it's clear that this is showing that you have warming, that in time the temperature goes up. I was looking in the audience, and I saw that these professors of law were going blank. Now, they didn't, and I said, well, do you understand the picture like this? If I show a picture like this. And they said, yeah, well, you remember something from high school. And so they are professors and they could not read a plot like that. So how can I imagine then that if I give a scientific presentation that people or politicians that often are not scientifically trained, that they understand what I'm talking about? Also a picture like that. I mean, for me, it's clear and I try to explain it, but for most people, an arrow that I show is something that shows you I go from A to B, no? It doesn't mean that there is a link between cause and consequence, no? Which is showed here. So I started to realize that, and I also realized that I had to talk in another way. So I started to do that, and the beauty is that if you start talking in another way about your scientific results, you come also to different conclusions. So let me go through that. So again, this picture here, which is rather scientific, you can say the same thing with this picture here. And that's a picture I made exactly 20 years ago, just to try to be a little bit more effective in the communication. So it tells the same thing. It says that climate is something which is cooked, let's say, which is determined at the global scale. It's determined by the balance of incoming and outgoing energy. So to begin, you have light from the sun, you have energy from the sun that is hitting the earth. It's warming the earth, that sets in motion the atmosphere. You have these currents in atmospheric motion, which determines where it will rain and where it will be dry, and which determines at the end where we live, where we find vegetation, where we find deserts, and it basically determines our human activities. So climate starts at the global scale and then determines the things locally. Of course, then the heat that we receive must also leave the Earth, and it leaves the Earth as heat, as infrared radiation, back to space. And so in normal times, you have a balance, you have an equilibrium between the energy that comes in and the energy that goes out. And so the temperature on Earth remains the same. It's like the money in your pocket. No, if you gain money in a certain way, and your income is as large as your expenses, well, the money in your pocket will remain the same, right? So that's the same with the energy budget over the Earth. So we talk about climate change today, and here we have to go from local to global and back to local. So what happens? Locally, we are emitting CO2, right, by driving our cars, by running our factories. These are local activities. We put CO2 in the atmosphere. That leads to the greenhouse effect. And that greenhouse effect leads to global warming, and then through this cascade of processes go back to local and leads to local impacts. Okay, the fact that I have to say something about CO2. The first thing I said is that CO2 is a greenhouse gas. CO2 is also important for life and for plants, is the food of plants and things like that, but it's a greenhouse gas, and that's the problem with CO2. There is another thing with CO2 that is often not said, and that's the fact that CO2, once you put it in the atmosphere, it stays there for a long, long time. No? If you drive your car in Brussels or in Milano and you emit, let's say, 100,000 molecules of CO2, then 20,000 of these molecules will stay there, will still be around in 1,000 years from now. So each time you drive your car, you sort of change the atmosphere in an irreversible way. You change the atmosphere basically forever. 1,000 years is a long time for a human, right? And so in this time, in these 1,000 years, the molecules have the time to mix in the global atmosphere, to travel around and mix in the global atmosphere. So of your 100,000 molecules you emit, after a couple of years, you will find some of them over the North Pole, some of them over the South Pole. They will find them everywhere. So your local emission, your local activity leads to a global problem, right? And that is unfair in many ways, because again, maybe a little bit exaggerated, it's our local emissions in the rich world, to say it very simply, our way of living, that causes a global problem, which then, through a cascade of processes, gives also impacts in the world, in countries that do not emit CO2, and that do not are in any way responsible to global warming. So we are responsible in the rich world, let's say, for also things that happen in the poor world where people are not at all responsible for it. That's unfair. It is also unfair in another way. You recognize these two persons here. The emissions that my generation have been put in the atmosphere and that will stay there for generations to come will impact the lives of you, of the young people, right? You will have to live with climate change. You will have to clean up the mess. And that's also unfair, right? So I came to believe that what is really wrong about climate change is that it is an ethical problem. And the question that we can pose is, who are we of my generation that we can compromise the future of the young generation, of our children and their children? And who are we at the rich side of the world that we can destroy lives and livelihoods at the other poor side of the world? And who are we, Homo sapiens, no? That we can destroy beaches and forests and kill birds and bees? And these are very difficult questions. And of course, these are questions for us all, but of course, more for people who are more responsibility and that bear more responsibility for these things, for this change, you know? But they are difficult questions because the answer is that we basically don't have the right to do these things, right? Okay, I want to make a comment also here. This last slide here, this slide, I only added 2 years ago to my talks. And that was because I was once giving a talk to high school students, people like you. And one young woman stood up and said, but Mr. Raz, why are you giving these lectures? Why do you do that? And I, of course, by that time I knew why I was doing that, but I realized that I never made it explicit why I was giving these talks and why I felt concerned about climate change. And as I told you, in the first, let's say, 15 years of these 20 years I'm doing that, I did it because of, it was a logical story. It was a nice, scientific, logical story. And the result is only that we have to do something of climate change because of all the damages. But 5 years ago, I started to sort of think also about my children, about children in general, and the sort of world we would leave behind now for them. And I thought this certain things were not fair, were unjust. I also started to go back to nature a little bit more. And this is a walk in the Alps, not very far from where I live. This is a glacier. I was passing there and I said, okay, I'm going to go to that glacier. And I went, I walked to the glacier. And I saw the glacier and the cracks in the ice, and I saw the water dripping. And this whole glacier looked to me like a living animal, like a whale, laying in these broad valleys, in this broad valley. And it looked like a dying whale. And I also felt, emotionally, that this is not fair, that this glacier is melting, is disappearing. It will disappear because of the way we live on this planet. And of course, this one here, I showed that before. Yeah, this is only 2 years ago, but I still get the goose bubbles. I know what that means. You mean that, no? This kippenvel in the Netherlands. The goose bubbles when I see that. Look at this animal. Look at his feet. No? This animal is supposed to hunt seals on the ice pack on the Arctic, but he doesn't do that anymore because he has troubles to get back to the land when the ice is retreated from the continent. So he has problems. He has to swim for 50 kilometers sometimes. So he doesn't do it, and he starts to roam the cities in North Siberia to look for food. Look at his feet. No, right? Is this, can we do that? What is the right? What right do we have as humans to destroy animals like that? And of course, humans themselves and the livelihoods of people. Well, going through all that, I also realized that you have to not only talk about the climate outside us, you also have to dare to talk about the climate inside yourself. No, you have to really talk about why you do things, no, your personal feelings and your personal thoughts. And I tell you that if you give a talk to a public, a real public, you know very well when there is total attention to what you say, because there is a very, very special silence in the room. And the silence happens not when I explain the greenhouse effect, but it's always there if you say something personal about your own thoughts and your own life. And that's not easy to do, right? But that's where you can connect best with your audience, if you say something about yourself. And because in the audience, everybody is sitting there as a personal with his own thoughts and his own feelings. And if you listen carefully, look at yourself, you listen carefully to somebody, you always try to sort of confront your own feelings and thoughts with the one who is staying on the stage, no? And that's of course not easy. It's easy to talk about science, but it's much more difficult to talk about things that you feel yourself. I think you remember that sentence here, end of a poem that we heard a couple of weeks ago, eh? For there is always light, if only we are brave enough to see it, if only we are brave enough to be it. And it's a very beautiful verse, but it's very difficult. It's not easy. It's not easy for many people. And I tell you, it's not easy for me myself to be the light. I mean, it means that you have to talk about yourself and about before you talk about others. Okay, back to reality, the hard reality, and back to policy and results. I have another 15 minutes, so I go a little bit fast now. Well, the whole climate issue became a policy issue, and an issue for politicians at the end, with James Hansen. I mentioned James Hansen before, who gave the first testimony about climate change before the US Senate. And he was talking to politicians and saying, look, there is a problem here, we better do something about it. Then the whole climate change scientific community came together in what is called the Intergovernmental Panel of Climate Change. I think you have heard about that. Every 5 years or so, it produces a big report which talks about the climate, the scientific, the climate science, basically, what we know, what we don't know. It talks about the impacts of climate change, and it talks about mitigation, the solutions, how we can reduce greenhouse gas emissions. So various reports, and basically that is spanning my scientific career. And these reports, if you read all of them, but I mean, it's all together, they will be a pile like that. There is increasing certainty that global temperature is linked to human activities. There is actually no doubt about that anymore among climate scientists. At the political level, under the United Nations, negotiations were started between all the countries that led to the Paris Agreement, or the Paris Accord, in 2015. 2015 for you maybe is a long time ago, but for me it looks like yesterday. So only after 21 years of negotiations, we came to an agreement that basically starts that there is a need for action to respond to the urgent threat of climate change. So let's say there is a universal acceptance that climate change is an urgent threat that should be tackled. And that's not only an agreement between politicians, but in these negotiations, and I joined a number of them. You have politicians, you have people from the business world, you have scientists, you have NGOs. They all come together to that agreement. So everybody, that's why I call it a universal agreement, that climate change is a problem. Okay, the agreement says, you know, that we want to stop the global average temperature 2 degrees above pre-industrial levels, pursuing efforts to keep it below 1.5 degrees. You can wonder why 2 degrees and 1.5, why not 3 degrees? Well, here I can say this is really a political decision, to stop at 2 degrees or try to go to 1.5 degrees. The only thing that science can do is say, okay, at 1 degree, you will have that sort of effects. And we have done that, and we see these effects. At 2 degrees, you have these effects. At 3 degrees, you have other effects. It's up to you, society, and politicians who represent society, to decide where do we stop, no? How much do we want to pay to stop climate change? And very quickly, and here I make a big jump in there's a lot of climate modeling behind that, a lot of studies behind that. But reaching 2 degrees means or requires that we zero the global net emissions of greenhouse gases by 2080. So it's not a question of reducing by 20% or 30%, it's really bringing it to zero. No? If you want to go to 1.5 degrees, we have to zero the emission by 2050, which is 30 years from now. And okay, what have we been doing so far? We can zero. I mean, the technology is available, and I will not say a lot about that. I will only show what we have been doing so far, because it's since 1990 that also at political level we start thinking about climate change. So what have we been doing since 1990? And what I show here is that the emissions of greenhouse gases in Europe, at least, have been going down. We know that the emissions globally are still going up, at least till 2020. I mean, 2020, they probably will go down because of COVID and the lockdowns. And of course, we have to zero the global emissions, but it's important to look at Europe, because Europe is actually showing to the rest of the world, to China and India, that it is possible to reduce the emissions of greenhouse gases and at the same time increase your economic activity, your well-being. This is shown here by GDP. Well, we know GDP is maybe not a perfect way to talk about well-being. It is not a way to talk about well-being. But in the lack of something else, we reduce emissions and we still are able to improve our economic activity and our well-being. So this is possible. And this is what Europe can show to the rest of the world. Then China, if China wants to do that, it can do it, because it's a different political system, and it can, if it wants it, and it's already doing it, reducing their emissions. Okay, if we now look at a little bit closer at the data, we see that it goes a little bit in waves, right? From 1990 to 2020. And the first going down was actually due to the modernization of the industries in Eastern Europe. After the fall of the Berlin Wall, there was an opportunity to modernize the dirty and the costly infrastructure of Eastern Europe. And that opportunity has been taken, has led to a reduction. Then the next big reduction was during the global financial and economic crisis in 2008 and 2009. Yeah, we have see a big jump here. And again, we will see a reduction in 2020 because of COVID. So you can say, if you're a little bit cynical, well, we are reducing emissions by disaster, no, and not by design. That's what the Americans say. You can do it by disaster or you can do it by design. So it looks that we have been doing it thanks to big structural changes and crises that we had in Europe. Well, that's only one way of seeing it. Look, in 2008, in the middle of the economic crisis, the European Union has come up with a directive to say, okay, we have to introduce now renewable energies. And that became law, and every country started to do it. And so they took the opportunity to do it, and we did it. Huh? This would be without this legislation, we would stay rather here, but with this legislation, we went down. And again, now in the middle of the pandemic, the European Union, so the leaders of the European Union, have decided in December last year to reduce the emissions by 55%. I hope you can see it, I cannot see it, in 2030, right? So in the middle of a crisis, the political world take the opportunity to put the legislation and say, okay, now we have to take the opportunity because of the fact that people are living differently, they work at home, they don't use the car so much anymore, and so on and so on. We take that opportunity to reduce the emissions even further. So I expand a little bit the picture. This is 1990 till 2050. We know that we have to reduce the net emissions, so we can still reduce a little bit in 2050 as long as we absorb the emissions by, for instance, planting trees. And well, if you see this picture now, you see the full picture now, you see what we have done in the last 30 years and you see what we have to do in the next 30 years. We're exactly halfway. I would like to ask you, are you positive? Are you optimistic? Are you pessimistic? Shall we make it in 2050 to reduce emissions? Because you see, I make a comment again, it's if you give talks about climate, but also if you give talks about COVID, and I just read a paper about that in the newspaper, there's always the balance you have to make between being, well, between scaring people, right? And say, look, you have to do this and that, because otherwise this and this, or leaving a door open and say, look, it's still possible that we're gonna make, that we're gonna get rid of COVID, that we're gonna be able to reduce the warming of global climate. There's always this balance. And Greta Thunberg, the activist, and she is the reason why I'm here, actually. Without the young people, I would not even be here. I would be doing other things. But she really used the scary method, no? The house is on fire and nothing is being done. She was basically successful in scare the people and his youngsters and to do something. You came on the streets. In general, communicators and educators think that you have to keep a little bit of a door open and be what I call possibilistic. No, it is possible. And as long as it is possible to do something about an issue, about climate change, you have to say that, and that's important. So I want to end the next 10 minutes or so by giving a number of reasons why we can remain possibilistic, why we can believe that we're gonna make it, right? That we're gonna reduce our emission, that we're gonna control climate change and avoid the worst of climate change. And the first reason is the data, right? If I look at that, I say, okay, we are on track, we are a little bit above it, but, and it's of course due to these big crises, but there will be crises also in the next 30 years. Of course, the catastrophic ones, we will try to, as a society, we will try to avoid crises, but crises will happen. And then I think politicians will be smart enough and responsible enough to sort of take the opportunity of a crisis and do something regarding climate and regarding other issues. So if I look at the data, I mean, that tells me that we can remain possibilist. As I said, unpredictable things always happen. I mean, you cannot say when they will happen. Eh? And that is something that we learn from complexity theory. Now, the climate system is a complex issue. And also a sand of pile that I show here is a complex sort of construct. If you add grains of sand to the top of the pile, not lit one by one, the pile will grow and the pile becomes steeper and steeper, right? So the pile comes under stress, and that's important. And then you add one single grain of sand and the whole mountain collapses. You get an avalanche. I think you can imagine that, right? This is what's happening. We cannot say which grain of sand, but we know that at one point, one more grain of sand will make the mountain collapse. And this is what happened with Greta Thunberg. It could be Greta Thunberg, it could be somebody else. But for 20 years, the scientists and communicators and educators have been talking about climate change, and we have tried to create awareness with everybody, with the young people, the old people. And we sort of, hardly managed to do it. And then comes Greta Thunberg, this little girl, this little grain of sand, and she is able to create awareness among millions of people, not only young people, but also leaders, political leaders, religious leaders, leaders, and so on. So these things do happen. Crises or unpredictable things do happen, and they don't always have to be catastrophic, no? So that's the reason for remaining possibilist. There will be technological breakthroughs. Sometimes it's unpredictable when they will happen, but they will happen. And I will not say a lot about that. Maybe this afternoon we can talk about that. Crises, even if catastrophic, are occasions to start doing things differently and avoid future ones. I talked about that. But also during crises, this is a good time for ideas to go viral, no? And cause social tipping points. Ideas that can be old ideas or ideas that can be new. And if you see the discourse that are happening in this in the last year, there are a number of old ideas that sort of getting through, that become viral. And one example is this simple one, no? That we too much in our modern consumeristic world, we see too much the our ecosystems, nature as part of the economy, whereas it's actually the opposite. We should see our human economy as part of nature, as the ecosystem, eh? Or more simply said, the world does not belong to us, we belong to the world. You know? The nature does not belong to us, we belong to nature. That's an old idea, but which gains again traction and goes somehow viral during times of crisis. Another example, what's happening, is this one, a very simple one. In our modern consumeristic culture, we say that something is valuable because it's expensive. Right? So the price determines the value of things. There's more and more talk, if you look on YouTube and things like that, that it should be different. And you don't have to think very long to say that the value of things should determine the price of things, not the opposite. And during COVID especially, we have learned what really is valuable to us, no? It's a good health, first place. It's being able to be together. No, it's being able to go to a concert together, to a piece of theater. These things we really miss, and this is why they are valuable. So if this is true, we should pay nurses, we should pay actors rather than paying bankers who just move money around. These are ideas that take traction during crisis and they go viral. And at the end, they can create what we call social tipping points. Huh? The social system is very, very complex, no? It's about culture, it's about cities, about energy system, and that's what we look at if we look at solutions for climate change. But it's also about education, about research, about financial markets, about activism and awareness. And each of these subsystems, well, they are like mountains of sand. They can, if you put them under stress, and you can put them under stress through activism, through education, through culture, then you can make something move very rapidly in each of these subsystems. And if you move something, for instance, the financial markets, this can rapidly have an impact on energy systems and cities, because you can make money available in milliseconds, right? On top, you have culture, which sort of takes everything together. And also we have to work on culture, no? And get beyond our consumeristic modern culture. So, and that's what I have been doing. I have been, just to finish, I have been working all the time in research and maybe education and policy. I changed jobs 5 years ago, really to work on culture, and that museum that I founded a couple of years ago is actually my humble contribution to also change culture and try to change something in our thinking about our life. Okay, final reason to remain possibilist is actually you, the young people, because Well, you are actually my favorite public. I've been talking to many publics, but you are my favorite public because you are 18, 20, 22 years old. You still think what to make out of your life. Maybe some of you still think what to study. Well, regarding study and professional careers, I mean, the previous slide showed that there is work for everybody. If you really want to change culture and go to another way of living, there is work for everybody, right? For engineers, for architects, but also for educators, for artists and things like that. So don't be afraid to take whatever you like to do. It's not what you do, it is how you do your profession that is important, that you do it with a certain responsibility towards yourself and also to others and to nature, right? How is more important than what. You are also my favorite public because you're enthusiastic, because you're young. I mean, if I give this first presentation with this big explosion and you all get excited, I feel like enthusiastic myself about that, because I feel that you see these problems very differently, right? Why? Because you have been raised with these problems from your childhood. You have been drinking these problems of climate change and new technologies and all these things with the milk bottle, right? So you see these problems very differently, I believe, because they are part of you. Climate change is a problem I see because I went through the rational, logical research mode, and I came to feel that climate change is a problem. For you, it's different because you have this problem inside you, more or less. You have heard about new technologies and solutions since ever. So you can more easily, I think, you are certainly better prepared to tackle it than the old generation. And I cannot believe that you are not going to do it. Again, there are many reasons to be pessimistic. And I'm thinking you're going to do it because you're going to see opportunities. In this crisis, you're going to see opportunities to make change. And you can do it for different reasons, and then I stop. You can do it because you have a real concern for planet Earth, no, and everything that it hosts, human and non-human things. You can be concerned about that, and you can want to do something about that. Or you can realize that if you do something, if you take the bus rather, or the train rather than the car, that you give more space to nature, you give more time to yourself, and you actually have a better life, right? That's another reason for changing things. Or you can simply see a business opportunity, why not? So there's a lot to do in the next 30 years before we reach 2050. A lot of opportunities also for, why not making money, as long as you do it in a responsible way, for yourself, for other people, also the other side of the world, and for nature and the planet, right? So I want to stop here. I think that's my last slide. Yes. And I hope we can talk about that this afternoon, or not this afternoon, in an hour time or so, about how you think about climate change also, and how you feel about it. And that's important to, probably the most important you have to first do. Why do I care about climate change? Why do I care about poverty in the world? Why do I care about biodiversity loss? And why do I want to go on the streets for that? Be the light for yourself in the first place. That's not easy. Anyway, thank you for listening. And I leave it to Luna and Ekaterina now.